Zoom.
Yeah, so I designed the path so that they can be separate. Because we do have one like that.
All right, let's get started on the fun part. So, and also as a note, I designed this four part as individual, independent and standalone from one another. So if you ever want to go back and try out different things, you can just pick the part that you want. You don't have to do one after another. So, and again, let's go to cell and let's clear all output. I don't have to do the where I am because I know exactly where I am. I'll go ahead and start with this command to read in the CSV and look at the first six lines of my data set. So this is my data set.
Are we still in part one?
No, we are in part two. So yeah. Intro to our part two. So in your work, you are going to manipulating a lot of data, and even though data frame access allow you to get data by the index, by the number of column, by the column name, in the end, what you need is going to be more complex than that. Most likely, you are likely to want certain type of data depending on certain type of condition. You might want to do some either flattening of the data or combine data into different columns. You might want to do some counting depending on categorical data and so on. And you can do all of that manually in R. It is just, it's slow and it's tedious and it's not natural to do it. So the package that we are going to look in next is one of the very common and popular package within R, and it allows you to manipulate data in, I would say, in a more natural fashion. That bucket is called dplyr. And to activate that bucket, you just need to type library dplyr and go ahead and shift enter. It will show that it loaded this bucket into your environment. So dplyr has a series of common functions, the select, filter, mutate, group by, summarize, and the pi function. And we will go through each one of them throughout this part of the workshop. I include a link here. There's a cheat sheet on how to do data manipulation. If you click on that, this is basically a PDF with visual indications and tell you, let's say you have certain type of data and you want to do certain type of manipulation, what type of function and what type of library you can do to make these transformations. So this will be a very useful cheat sheet to keep. So let's start by this. Within the data set, you can select your column. And this is done by typing the select functions, the name of the data set, and then the series of columns that you want to select. So this is convenient. You can also do the same thing by typing in survey and the square bracket, and then the comma and column. So this allows you, this is an alternative to that approach. And again, because we have 34,000 lines, let's try assigning it to a variable and just look at some of that. And let's just look at head of x. So this gives me a new data frame from survey with the following column, plot ID, species ID, and weight. And then another example is the filtering. In filtering, you are filtering rows. So I want to filter my survey data set such that any element, any observation within my year are equal to 1995. So if I run this, this gives me back a data frame, and you can see all of the column up here are 1995. So you can set up a filter. So you can select and you can filter. Is nothing special. Let's go ahead and clear this output. What makes dplyr and what makes me find dplyr very useful is the ability to combine multiple select and filter actions through the pipe. And this is one of the action that listed above, the percent greater percent, it denoting a pipe. Yes.
Does that filter function work for, does it work for categorical data too? Or is it just for numbers?
It works for categorical, it works for character data as well.
Okay.
So what filter does is, how do I find a good metaphor for this? It's like you have a pipe of clay and you have a machine that basically you push the clay through, and it, as it goes through certain stages, the clay is starting to be shaped and bent depending on what you want. It's like an assembly line. That's what this pipe are. So what this represents is I have my survey data. I push it through a pipeline, and at the first stage, I want to filter out anything that has weight less than 5. And then I put this through another pipeline, and the resulting from this filter are going to be select only the species ID, sex, and weight column. So this is what I ended up with. So all of the species ID, all of the sex, all of the weight, and all the weights are going to be guaranteed to be less than 5. So this is possible to do using a very clever combination of N and R conditions. I want to filter out anything that has weight less than 5, and I want to only select the species ID, the sex, and the weight. So you can do it within one statement using R standard statement. But by putting it into the pipeline, it might you be able to visual how your data are being transformed across the stages. I have my data set, I'm going in and filter out anything less than 5. I'm going to just pick out certain things from that data set and printing it out. So this is why I see it as a more natural way to approach data manipulation. You are manipulating data stage by stage by stage until you get to what you want. And you can assign the entire pipeline to a variable and have the variable output. So again, if I run this, I get the same thing. The only thing is that the result from that pipeline is now stored in a variable.
So you need to have, you need to assign a variable name, and then all the pipes, and then that same variable name at the end of it.
Yeah.
Almost like
oh, no. This variable is just for me to print out the result.
Uh-huh.
So what you really need, you actually only need, so let me split it into two. So I can say that, and I can do, let's say I can do str survey XML, and it show me what I have.
So you that pipeline will create some data value, and you want to assign those data value to a variable.
Mm-hmm.
So an exercise to use this pipe. Can you subset our data to include individual collected before 1995? and return only the column here's size and weight. So how do you do that? How do you subset the data to get the individual collected before 1995 and keep only year, sex, and weight?
This is awesome. And yesterday I was looking at my data set in Excel. Like, that's going to be a lot of work cleaning.
Yeah, deep file is great.
Yeah.
So to do this tab, first you take the survey data and you pipe. And the first stage of the piping, you are going to filter year less than 1995. And the next stage of piping, you are going to select whatever data you want. So another thing that I think I haven't mentioned yet is, because you are starting with this data set at the beginning of the pipe, in all the later stages of your pipeline, you can use this variable name. This variable name as use the column name as the variable name directly. So it allows you to interact with your data set in a very natural way. It allows you to automatically grab all the column names and just start using it as the variable in your operations. So if I run this, that gives me back all of my data that is prior to 1995. And lots of missing data. Yes, you can filter a range. Let me see. You can put in, so for example, let's say I want to filter between 1995 and 2000. So I can do year less than 1995, and years greater, less than 2000. When you do multiple conditions, make sure it is just good practice to include each condition within its own parentheses. Let's see. So you can filter for range. This is one way to do it. Another way to do it, if you don't want to really worry about setting up the AND and the OR, the second way to do it is just put in another filter. Filter year less than 2000. Because basically filtering a rank is just you chop one side and you chop the other side, right? So I can do that. That actually simplifies my life and my coding much better than trying to use a combined condition. I can filter for anything that greater than 1995, and then I filter for anything that less than 2000, and I run that. And that basically still gives me the same thing. It's just now more readable. So that's, again, that's the nice thing about the dplyr is it allows you to just break all of your conditions, how you want to filter it, how you want to shape your data into small, tiny, tiny steps. And as you work through this step, it will guarantee you that your manipulation is correct.
So when you enter the second filter line, how did you align them?
There is no exact rule on how you want to align them. I just align them because it's a natural tab from here.
When I tab them, they're not aligned. I have two spaces to align.
Oh yeah, so two spaces is also a good choice. So we have covered select and filter and the pipe character, and the next element is mutate. What mutate does is it actually adds more data to your data set depending on your existing data. So in this example, I pipe my survey data through the process, and in the process, I want to create a new column called weight kilogram. That is the convert of weight from gram to kilogram. And I want to look at that. So you can actually pipe into the head functions in order to view just the first six lines of the data. You will not need the parentheses after the head functions to do that. So if I run this statement, that gives me everything, and then you have weight, and then you have weight in kilogram. A new column has been added. So on that note, if I look at my survey data now, so this is another nice thing about dplyr is when you modify data using dplyr, it essentially creating a new data set for you and it doesn't impact your existing data. So this is my manipulations. I run the survey, I add the column. I have a new data frame that has that weight kilogram column, but my original data frame is still here and it's not changed. So if I want to go back, I can still go back to my original data.
So you can just powering through this. So you can actually use the filtering in the, from the previous step, and then the mutate to actually add a new label.
Yeah.
If you're like, I'm thinking about like, I'm forward stepping this, but for instance, using labels as factors as labels in, for instance, machine learning projects or something like that, you know, for other statistical analysis or things like that, in which you actually need to separate into different classes, you can actually use the mutate to add a new label, an arbitrary label for something for a project. Mutate, you can use mutate for something like that. You can actually, because you have a label class, you can use mutate based on the information from your data frame.
Yeah. So in using mutate, this is simple. You can actually put functions inside mutate, more complex function if necessary, to depending on how you want to transform this data set. It is possible to do that.
Because if you have something like a threshold, a given threshold, for instance, a weight, something like you have, or something like 0.5, or a given threshold, you can actually say that, like, if it's more than 0.5, when you say mutate, then give that this label.
Yeah.
You can actually build something like that with R.
Yeah.
And then, you know, just give that a new label.
Yes. It is possible to do that. Mutate will allow you to do that. So you can write, so this is a direct function. So let's see.
Because that's pretty, like, that's way more automatic than, and less error prone than actually doing it like manually.
I think I have some example later on that show you how to do that. It's still using simple function, but yes, you can apply external function inside mutate to transform your column.
Okay.
So let's go. So let's just try that. So in this statement, what you see when we do the first filter is it doesn't give you anything useful because we have a lot of weight that are NA, which is not a number. So what we can do is we can add in a layer of filtering before we perform a mutate, and the dot is not NA, is it will determine whether on some observation is a missing value or not. And the exclamation point negates a logical value. So in the filter here is that I want to get anything that is not is NA. So this is a double negative. That is not missing any value. And then I mutate that. So when I run that statement, I actually have something that has the weight, and the weight transform into kilogram. So
if I want to under 6, if I want to, if I have more than 3 categories, and if I want to, if I have, for example, 5 categories and I want to select 3 of them, how do I filter? Basically, how do I filter for more than one category?
So, which category? So, let's pick one. So, let's bring out, let's pick something, str of surveys. So we have, let's say species ID is something with 48 level. Let's say I want to just go ahead and select AB, AH, and AS. So surveys piping through, I want to filter, let's start with the most standard one. I want to see if my species ID Yep, and it was as simple as that.
I want to filter any of my category data that is the percentage in percentage is indicate that the element is part of this vector. So if any observation within my species ID is either AB, AH, or AS, I am going to keep those.
So let me try one more time. Let's do this, let type X equal to survey, and let's do structure of X. So filter species IDs. Oh, this is still 24 level. Summary X is after of X. Oh, my bad. Yep.
So you can see after I run this filter, my species ID within X only has AH, AB, and AS.
So let's go ahead and work on this exercise. Let's create a new data frame that contains the species ID column and a new column called input half, and this containing the value that I have, the input length. There should be no NAs and all values are less than 30 in this input half column. So survey I want to go ahead and filter out anything that is not value. So input underscore length. So I want to filter all of those down. And then I want to create a new column called input half, which is equal to input length divided by 2. And then I want to filter out anything. I want to select anything that is less than 30. And I don't want to bring down everything, so I only want to select species ID and output health. Let's see if this is correct. It seems like that is correct.
So again, as you can see, dplyr allows you to almost give a verbal description of your data, almost similar like how you are narrating, how you transform the data.
Except for that, so I want a new column called input half that I have the input length. There are no NAs. The input half is equal to input length divided by 2. All of my input half value at less than 30, and I want to keep only the species ID and the input half column.
So
Dplyr allows you to narrate how you want your data to transform. Oh, sorry. So let's go to the next part. Some of the more common data analysis patterns usually happen where you split your data into different groups. You apply analysis to each group and you combine the results. And that leads to the next two functions that we have within Dplyr, which is called group by and summarize. The name, they are often goes together. It is self-explanatory. In group by, you are grouping your data, you are grouping your observations into separate groups depending on the categorical data level. And based on each group, the summarize will perform a function across the entire group that you define over here. So for example, I want to identify the average weight of the animals, of the species, depending on the sex. In that case, I can take my, I can group by the sex, I can summarize the mean weight equal to the mean of the weight information. And I want to remove all missing data. So if I run this, I actually ended up with this. So I have three groups, the missing value, the female, and the male. And on each group, all of the weight from all of the weight observations from each group are calculated, the mean of those observations are calculated and assigned to a new column called mean weight. So for the missing one, there's 64, female 42, male 42.99. You can also perform more complex grouping, like hierarchical grouping. So if I want to group by sex and species IDs, so I can actually have the sex as in male and female, and sex, male, female, and missing. So you can see here the first column, there's the female and then there's the male. And for each of the category within the sex column, you have an equivalent category for the all the species. So I have missing sex with species ID of AB. I also have for M, I don't have the M on AB. But there should be something like that. And then for each combination of the sex and the species, I can have the average weight of all observations within that combination of grouping.
Excuse me, what was the NA that RM?
NaN is mean not a number.
Oh.
That means something happened, and even within this data set, there are something that trigger the NaRM and give you back not a number. So sometimes NaRM for the mean, even when you do NaRM, either true, it doesn't clean out all of the Na. So what you can actually do is set up a preliminary filter that removes the East Na from all the way before you do the grouping. So now you actually have the weight for everything. The outcome of a survey pipeline to group by and summarize is stored as the data table data structure. This is a special data structure of the dplyr. It doesn't override data frame. It just means that your data frame also have an additional table underscore df data structure characteristic. So you can see everything stay almost the same. The structure of X is still contain the data frame. What it does is it allow the print, when you print out the data, it print out fewer rows of data and as many columns as can fit onto one screen. So for example, if I want to print this, it print out very few data set. It prints out just a portion of the data. Instead, if you were using the print on the data frame, it prints out by default 1,000 lines. And as you can group by multiple categories, you can also produce multiple summarizations. So I can calculate the average weight and the minimum weight for all of my grouping. So this is the minimum average, this is the minimum, and so on. And then if I just want to count things, I have a function called tally that just basically count everything that I have within my groupings. So these are some of the examples that we can try out. So how many individuals were caught in each block type survey using group by and summarize to find the mean, minimum, and maximum hand foot length for each species? What was the heaviest animal measured in each year? You saw above how to count the number of individuals using group by and tally. How can you get the same result using group by and summarize? So there's a function called m, which basically just counting things. It's almost similar to tally. So on the first one, surveys want to group by, so we want to group by plot type. Tally. So again, very quickly, it gives me plot type, number n, and how many plot type that we have. And then on the second one, let's clear that cell. Survey. So I want to filter out any weight that is not available. I want to group by the one to type for each species. So I want to group by species ID. Let's see, similar, okay, so I can do that. So I want to summarize. So the first summarize is mean input is equal to mean input length, mean input equal to mean input length, and max input equal to max input length. So I can use filter, group by, and summarize to find the average, mean, the mean, minimum, and maximum length for each species. And let's run that. Typo. Let's run that again. Okay, so it turns out that there are some species that doesn't have a input length, I believe. Oh, yeah. I should have removed its LA of input length rather than weight. My bad. That was strange. There we go. So on the third one, how do I do the third one? On the third one, let's see. I want to get the heaviest animal. So first, I want to filter all the weight. This time, weight is correct. I want to filter the heaviest animal, so I want to group by species ID. If I group by that and I calculate the filter, see what does that give me. So species ID BA it won each year. So for each year, I have a set of species ID and genus that has the max wave. And then on the last one, count the number of individuals using group by and summarize. Let me try this one more time. Group by year. There we go. So for this one, it actually gives me the max, and it doesn't give me the remaining select. You can actually do multiple group by. So after I do the group by year with species ID and genus, I can actually go back and summarize my data and group by my year one more time to just select the highest weight per year for the yearly month. So you can do some more complex filtering and put multiple group by together to just keep filtering out data. I don't think this is the correct answer for this one yet. Go ahead and do the fourth one. Count the number using group by and summarize. Count the number of each sex. So let me do a copy. And instead of tally, we're going to use summarize count equal to end of count the number. I just got the mobs. Oh. Record writing. So instead of doing tally, I can use summarize count equal to n. The n function doesn't take any variable. It will just apply the n function to the count. It applies the n function to the entire data set and count how many entries. And then in the last part of this part two, we'll talk about, let's say you have clean up your data set, you have a very nice data, but now the function that you want to use or you export this is not in R, but more in SAS or Stata. So you want to save your data out of a file that you can move to another medium. So this is an exporting data to file, and this is also where we look at conditional statement within R. So if something is true, you do something else, you do something else. So in this body of code, first I get my current working directory and I assign a name called output underscore data to my output data directory. If the output data directory does not exist yet, I want to create a new directory, which is the combined of my current directory and my output data directory. This is just putting one path after another. If it exists, bring down directory already exists. So looking at my intro to R, my output data does not exist yet. So if I run this for the first time, nothing happened. I go back and I see a new directory is created. If I run this one more time, now I see the second statement of the condition being run. Directory already exists. So we are looking at two new command here, actually three. The file exists, check to see if a certain directory exists. The create that directory, and find path, you basically build a path between build a correct path. The reason that we have find path is find path is a new function from R that just began around, I think, R 2.0. Before then, you build a path by just typing in a string that describes the entire path. And sometimes it becomes a problem when you try to move your code between, say, Linux or Windows or Mac, because they use different way to denote the path. I think for Windows, it is the backward slash, and then for Linux and Mac, it is a forward slash to separate between the directory. So what FindPath does is it only takes in either a correct string or it can just take in the individual directory name. And depending on this order, it will create the correct path for you on any operating system that you are running the code on. So when you say FindPath and you run the code on Linux, it will be a FindPath according to the Linux standard. The same body of code you run on Windows, it will build the path according to the window pathing. So this will ensure that your code always works across all cases. So let's say I want to create a new data set with all of the missing observations removed for the measurement. So I want to remove the weight and remove the hind foot length and remove any missing sex. And then I remove any rare species, anything that has less than 50 observations. So I have my survey complete. I can filter it one more time. group by species ID and count and filter out anything that greater than 50. And then on my survey complete, I only, so this is an example where you use two data set to filter. So this is probably how three should be happened. I want to create a new data set that contains the maximum weight over the year, and then I only filter out any element that anyone that has the weight that matching that max. So within this, survey complete is survey complete, and filter out that I only take species ID that is part of the species listed in this common list. And then I will write, when you read the data, it's read.csv. So when you write data, it's write.csv. I write this data set, the file is my file path, so the output data there that we created above. And I also need the file name, survey complete.csv, row name equal to false. I don't want to include the row names. And I run that. If you go back to the home directory and click on output data, you will see the surveycomplete.csv file created. And you can see this is how it looks. So any questions on this part?
Yes, that's it for the morning. We're going to have about 1 hour break, and we'll be back here at 1 p.m. to look at visualizations of data in R.
Yes.
I can't see the white.
Okay, yeah. So group by.
So the first one is group by plot type.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's kind of like when I.
Oh, you need one more. So that's the one. You don't need to put a variable on that one.
No, there's no need.
Yeah, there's no
store
need. So actually, remove this white line. Remove the empty line after the time.
Good.
Yeah, okay, run that. So tally itself is a function call.
I'm sorry?
Tally is a function call. It's not a variable name.
It's not. It's actually a...
Yeah, it's a function call.
Okay. And that gives you plot type, which is what we have here.
So you group everything by the plot type, and then you tally everything within each group.
Okay. The second one was?
The second one is?
Use group by again.
Yeah.
And you summarize, which is another of the
functions
you have. Define mean, the minimum, and the max. Okay, and that's one of the columns that we had. then for each species using species ID. So we have services media.
Is not a number, two and you is FA is not a number, so this is for not a number.
Okay.
The empty space is not missing value, you have a value which is meaningless.
Okay.
So remember, we talk about the difference between not putting not putting something into a cell versus putting a single space in a cell. You see the same thing, it's not the same thing.
Okay.
So that's the difference between this and that.
Okay.
This is the local core.
Thank you.
This was very helpful. That's why I still remember this. So go ahead and save it first.
Yep.